Please, Professor Scavia can start the session.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So thank you very much for the introduction. Good afternoon to everybody. And I have to say that it is really a pleasure for me to introduce the special lecture given by Claudio Margottini, one of the best experts in the application of geology and rock mechanics to the conservation of artistic heritage all over the world. It is not possible. I gave a look to the. I know very well Professor Margottini, and but I had a look to the his curriculum, and it is impossible to mention here the huge number of activities carried out by him. So I will only recall what impressed me very much, that is that in collaboration with UNESCO, he was responsible of the project of restoration of the almost all the artistic heritage sites all over the world. I hope to pronounce the name of the sites, but just to give you an idea, Tiwaraku site in Bolivia, Petra in Jordan, Byzantine monasteries of Georgia, in particular Varza site, Easter Island Moai, Apsum Obelisk in Ethiopia, Machu Picchu in Peru, Buddha Nichis in Afghanistan, and Imperial tombs in North Korea, and many others. Today he will give us a presentation where he remains in the Mediterranean region, and the name of the presentation, the title, sorry, of the presentation is Weak Rocks in the Mediterranean Region, Structures and Threats of Cultural Rupestrian Heritages. Please, Claudio.
Thank you very much, Professor Scavia. Thank you very much, Claudio, for these very kind presentations. I'm really, I suppose you can hear me well.
Yes.
Okay. Perfect. So we are really very, very happy to be invited for this this interesting conference that is just discussing the topic of weak rock claims and shale in the Mediterranean region. The Mediterranean region is a country in which we are deeply involved. Also, for my last activity as a diplomatic in the embassy of Italy in Egypt, in which the cooperation between the Mediterranean countries, it's one of the milestones, one of the most important elements. But going on now to the topic of today, I'm just sharing the screen. Okay, I think now it's okay. Perfect, weekend. So the topic today is just to discuss about the weak rocks in the Mediterranean region. So the present lecture is introducing this subject and related also conservation issues. But rupestrian settlements and all rock cut sites were among the first man-made works in the history of humanity. It is made of structure excavated in the rocks and making benefit from the availability of weak rocks or the presence in earlier period of natural hollows and or rock shelters. Typical examples are from all over the Mediterranean region. We can see here some maps from Italy, Etruscan rupestrian site, from the Caucasus, from Middle East, an example from Afghanistan that is a little bit far away, but still belonging to the same domain. And typical example, as I mentioned, were from all over the Mediterranean region. And sorry, this is automatically going on, I don't know why. And considering, and they are mainly dated back to the years before the Christian era, like Egyptian, Egyptian, Etruscan, Hellenistic, Nabatean, and early Christian structure, as well as underground town and churches in Christian, Byzantine, and medieval period, like in Caucasus, in Anatolia, in Ethiopia. So up to now, from the information we have, there is a beautiful project developed by an Italian team in Bari and the Italian Astrological Association, which counted in the Mediterranean around 1,948 rupestrian sites distributed through 31 countries. But most very important is the reason for why the sites has been settled in a specific place. Clearly common elements among the sites are the presence of predisposing factors such as geomorphology, isolating the steppe cliff or large medium, isolating large monolithic blocks, the presence of medium soft rock to be excavated to obtain a distinctive rupestrian architecture, coupled with the presence of joints and discontinuities supporting an easier carving on surface. Due to the weakness of parent material, as well as the impact of climate change threatened by a rapid and slow instability process, especially in the recent period, most of the sites are nowadays in a precarious equilibrium, or even destroyed or disappeared, with a significant acceleration in recent period. Here we can have some example. This is Norcia, is the Etruscan rock art necropolis in central Italy. Hegra is the largest tomb area in Saudi Arabia, just recently opened to the tourism. This is the second town in the Nabatean Empire, the first town of which was Petra in Jordan. And also in the Caucasus, with some places that were just at the crossroads of many civilizations and culture and invasions. So there was the need to have some military position to defend the sites, like this monolith in the Caucasus. So going into the detail for the materials, for the sites, we have just to say that all the sites in which we have been working, at least in the Mediterranean, reported in this diagram, are characterized by very low strength, or low strength in some cases, or mainly is very low strength and high porosity, and high porosity for the materials. And this is according to the typical classification. So the material clearly to be excavated near to be, I don't say soft because it's been in some cases preserved up to now, but clearly not very strong. So was also the influence of divinities. This is one of the most beautiful ancient quarry we can find. This is the Dadan in Saudi Arabia as well. We can see in the middle part of the slides, there are some quarries. This is an ancient quarry to extract due to the discontinuities and the strength of material, blocks to fortify the nearby towns. But also these blocks, this area, after cleaning, was used as a necropolis. So many of the tombs has been excavated in this area, using the joints to accelerate the process of carving or excavation in order to have a simplified way. Similarly, is in Bamiyan, Afghanistan, in which the niches containing the Buddha destroyed in 2001 by Taliban were excavated and carved in the rock, also making reference and support to some big cracks that were affecting affecting the site. But these sites are affected by, as we said before, by many threats that are including rock instabilities, like in Petra, in Jordan. This is the collapse of a tomb in 2009. Weathering, and we will see an example in Lalibela in Ethiopia about weathering. And finally, the men, unfortunately, like we said before, the destruction of a giant Buddha status of Banyan in 2001. So all these elements provided during the time and during the many years we have been working to develop an approach in which before arriving to the midtime, that means to the conservation of the site, we have to investigate in very detail all the many elements like the parent materials, the joints, topography, in order to develop the first geotechnical model, then develop a stability analysis. And finally, any mitigation design has to be combined with the archaeology and history of art in order to maintain integrity and authenticity of the heritage sites, but also to be combined with social sciences. That means as much as possible to make reference to local knowledge and traditional expertise in solving our problem. And this is a clearly important point we will see in detail in the next slide. Bamiyan, I put also some slides just to introduce the problem. The Bamiyan Buddhas were covered in the 5th to 6th century in one of the southern branch of the Silk Road. It's a beautiful landscape, a beautiful country, and let me say beautiful people living there. And the two statues were destroyed. And when we arrived, we tried to reconstruct, for instance, the geology. We made some, we tried to make the geology. And what we recognized was, for instance, that in the statues, we have an alternance of siltstone, that is the yellow and the red color, and conglomerate. But unfortunately, the siltstone is easily slaking. I can accelerate the movie a little bit. In few minutes, the siltstone is leaking, but the conglomerate, no. And that is because the conglomerate has a special carbonate cement that is maintaining the integrity of the integrity of the rock. And in understanding the parent material, it's important for further consolidation. And another example was in La Libella. La Libella is one of the most important places for the Christianity in Ethiopia. It was developed in the 12th century after that the Muslim conquest halted the Christian pilgrimages to the Holy Land. So many churches have been carved in the rock. Each one that you can see here, this is not a construction. This is a church sculptured, carved in the rock. But inside this, you have the altar, you have the windows, you have the stairs, the columns, the altar, everything. But this rock were affected by weathering phenomena. You can see the roof of this of this church. This is the Beit Abba Lebanon church. So working on that, even in the past, they recognized that the problem of water was important. They used some shelters to protect. When we were working there, we made some X-ray diffractograms, scanning microscope, thin section. And what we found was the presence that was never detected before of a special clay minerals that was a montmorillonite belonging to the smectic family. And this montmorillonite is expanding 10 to 20 times its volumes when it's affected by water. And also during the dry, it's also reducing the volumes from 10 to 20 times. And this is producing an erosion of the roof of the church, as in this case. So clearly, making investigation in the parent materials, it requires the understanding of all the possible elements we are dealing with that are affecting the sites. Similar in Bardia, I don't go into detail of Georgia because we already introduced the importance of parent materials. Georgia is a rock cut city and composed by more than 600 hidden rooms spread all over 13 floors, and is affected by many rockfall and also weathering, but mainly is rockfall affecting the site. In the area, we have been working since 2011 and developing many approaches. We will see some of those of them today. For instance, starting from the laser scanning. So in order to have a high resolution topographic map for the area. And we use this data. We use this data to, oh, sorry, I don't know what's happened in this one. There is some problem on it. So we use this, I don't know what's happening in this. There is one slide. Anyway, we use the semi, the laser scanning for a semi-autoreduction of slope or discontinuities that were affecting the site. And with the discontinuities, we can see later in Petra, in Jordan. Petra is the famous capital of the Nabatean Empire. We used a similar approach using the laser scanning and then developing stability analysis. The laser scanning we can see from here. I reduced the volume clearly. And this is the Sikh, the canyon going to the ancient Petra. Petra was probably one of the most surveyed by laser scanning archaeological site in the world when we did this project in 2011, 2015. And this is the famous treasury. We connected all the discontinuities and then we identified the characteristic of the rock and also the characteristic of discontinuities. And we used to define, to transform this data into a kinematic analysis and then a kinematic model that means understanding the possibility in a given surface of rock of having a planar sliding like in the left side or a wedge failure like in the right slides. These elements are important because Petra is not a stable town. As we can see in this slide, this is in 28th of May, there was a collapse and this collapse was recorded by a group of Italian tourists that were there just a few seconds before the collapse. And you can imagine what's happened in Petra if some blocks like this are falling down and then impacting on the people. In fact, 2 years ago in 2018, one simple block was falling down and was killing one person in Petra, one Italian tourist over there. And going back to our methodology, the block that was collapsing, we already detected with the laser scanning. We analyzed with our kinematic analysis. And this is exactly the block that was collapsing. So it means that this technique is supporting and helping in understanding, in the management of the site. So just a few words about Egypt. We mentioned about the relevance about the cracks and the discontinuities. But sometimes the cracks and discontinuities are not easy to detect, like in the case of Abu Simbel, because you know it was relocated and reconstructed in 1966, mainly by an international project coordinated by Swedish people, but in which Italy played very important roles. We collected in Abu Simbel, we found that the engineer and the group that was defining the first projects, that is Professor Gazzola, that was also the founder of the ICOMOS, International Council of Monuments and Sites, that is supporting UNESCO now with thousands of inscribed people. He made in 1960 the first project before the final one, but also he detected, he understood the importance of rock mechanics. So he made a survey of all the cracks that are there. And also, if you can see in this image that is just reporting the entrance of the temple, you can see most of the cracks just having the same deep direction of the surface of the surface of the cliff, just the same direction of the slope face. In fact, if we go in detail, we can see there are a family of cracks that is just exactly the same that has been used for the excavation by the ancient Egyptians. But also this family of joints probably was the reason for the collapse of one of the heads of the statues because one of the cracks was just cutting this statue, as we can see in the slide in the right side. So this is interesting because it means that the ancient Egyptians, they investigated possibly some of the rock mechanics characters of the rock before constructing the temple. But this temple is very well known because twice a year, the light is arriving at the end of the temple and not in the other, in the rest of the year. So the temple is very well known for the combination of architecture and astronomy by ancient Egyptians. But probably since the temple has been constructed also considering the slope failure and the slope face and the discontinuities there, I wonder if in some way, in together with the astronomy and the architecture, we can consider also rock mechanics as part of the background, the know-how of ancient Egyptians. And we are working on this project. But in understanding the site means sometimes to use new technologies, like in Varzia, again, the infrared thermography. And we use the infrared thermography after rainfall in July and November 2016, in this case, just to understand after a few days where the concentration of moisture is, because the concentration of moisture is relevant to understand the runoff, the runoff of the water over there. And these data were then combined with the hydromodeling analysis in order to understand the behavior of the soil, of the cliff, also considering that in the upper part of the cliff, there were some structures, some wall structures that we can see in the upper part here, that were concentrating the water in two major channels, that are channels connected with the master joints in there. But what we found for the remote sensing, the infrared, that also other minor joints were producing important moisture. So it means that the water is also in some way appearing from some springs that are located just at this level of the site. All this information clearly is essential for understanding from the geology, that is exactly here, this is the case of Petra, the topography, and then finally the slope stability analysis. And this is an essential point before going into the consolidation and stabilization. But the slope stability is a technique we can use like in this model, but in our case, it's important, for instance, as again in the case of Varzia, to understand the impact of blocks into the tourists, the people that are living there. This is a test that was done in several blocks, and then understanding how one single block that we already detected on the cliff, if running out, can affect the people that are walking on the track like this. But also modeling, it's important. Now is another small case. This is Alula in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. It's one of the most beautiful towns. This is also Nabatean period. Nabatean means Petra. This is the second most important town in the Nabatean Empire. It's in Saudi Arabia now, but this was also the border of the Nabatean with the local Dadanids, but it was also the border of the Roman Empire in Saudi Arabia. And affected by many problems of slope stability and collapses. And one, for instance, is in the ancient town of Alula. There is an ancient town just in this oasis, because this area is an oasis. Clearly, it was inhabited for this reason. This area was recently restored, but there was no attention to the possibility of some collapse coming from the cliff. But as you can see in the cliff, there are many, many collapses, rocks that has already collapsed. So it was quite normal to expect that some other may occur in the past. And then making very simple 2D modeling in this case, we recognize that there is a very high possibility that some blocks falling from the top can reach the town and then can damage not only the archaeological site, but affecting people. And this is one of the projects where we are working in this period. But understanding if the blocks are stable or not, it's also sometimes a matter not only of modeling, but also some deterministic approach, like in this case with the passive seismicity. So we use it to record the case of Varza in Georgia to detect the environmental noise for the instruments. Just for instance, we can see here, close to the cliff and inside a cave. And you can see the very high difference, especially when the upper part, there are some blocks that are weather disconnected from the local joints. And this is not occurring inside. And as you can see, this behavior is not only in one case, but we have in all the upper, in all the surface measurement, this one in the lower part, while in the internal part of the cliff, in the caves, the displacement, the horizontal displacement is quite lower. In this case, it's the particle motion, the horizontal particle motion recorded in the site. So this information clearly are important for understanding the ground profile and the geotechnical modeling, but we have to understand also the behavior of the site we are dealing with. So it means monitoring. But monitoring in archaeological site has many problems, like environmental constraints and limits, open space and limited space, sometimes no energy supplies. But also we need in archaeological sites to limit the impact techniques. We need a simple and flexible system, sometimes with time and budget limitation, but also we need a high technology solution, possibly transforming the monitoring system in the warning system, and hopefully to be used by local people. So it needs to implement the knowledge of local people in some of these techniques. Some examples of what we have done in the past, clearly one of the less impacting monitoring system is the remote sensing, is a satellite radar interferometry, that in which we can measure with accuracy of millimeter from the satellite the possible displacement in an archaeological site. In this case, is Petra, in which we detected the sun blocks that were possible moving on the upper part of the cliff. But clearly, monitoring from satellite is not satisfactory when you have vertical cliffs like this. So it's creating some problems, and it's not satisfying all our requirements. And another technique we used, for instance, in Varzia was the use of ground-based radar interferometry. And this ground-based radar is, for instance, registering about 36,000 pixels from 800 meters in Varzia without absolutely impacting on the archaeological sites. And the accuracy is quite good, as we can see in these slides. This is the evolution, for instance, in August, October 2009 in the upper part. But if you go in the detail, we had a small collapse in 2019. This small collapse was detected by the system, even if it was very, very limited in volume. Another technique that we used in Petra, in this case, was the geodetic monitoring, that is the traditional monitoring, but in reflectorless manner. That means to have just a few mirrors, few prisms in the area, just 4, 5, 6 to be used for the relocation of the system. And then periodically you can arrive on the site and then to measure some specific you have been defining just in the first time you have been on the site, you have been working on the site. And this was useful for understanding the evolution and the trend of some of these cliffs. But in the Petra, in the canyon that we saw before in the laser scanning, we also use a traditional geotechnical instrument, wire extensometer, crack gauge, tilt meter, but in a Wi-Fi environment, so without any cable line, and connected with a gateway, with a meteo station, in which all the informations can be transferred with a simple portable telephone, with a simple cellular, can be transmitted to the main gate that is, in this case, it was located in Switzerland. These are some examples of the approaches that we did, and all these informations clearly were quite useful for supporting not only the mitigation measures, but also the modeling, like in this case, that was one of the modeling in Petra, in which the most reasonable deformation was a process for tilting. So going back to the conservation policies and management, clearly any project like this has to consider knowledge and solution. So it means to have the best possible knowledge, and you saw some of these examples. We have to have low environmental impact, non-invasive. We have to implement sustainability, that means enhancing traditional sustainable practice. And also to have a socio-economic impact, possibly that means employing local manpower, local materials, in order to give some opportunities to the people that are affected, especially in developing countries. Some examples, I will go very fast now because we already discussed most of the topics. We selected in Varzia most of the unstable blocks, and we transformed this information into a master plan in which we decide some blocks to be stabilized with anchor, yellow one, but using scaffoldings, other one in red using climbers. We decided to put a net because some blocks were is an area with producing many small blocks falling down, to protect the edge of the cliff, and to stabilize the water falling down into the channel like this. And we started also with some temporary measurement, and the local people were completely supporting our project also because our approach was just to define what to do, and generally use the local people for realizing the job. So the Minister of Culture in Georgia invested in order to have one company doing this kind of job, and we succeeded to have this. I don't go in the detail of the mathematical modeling for the different blocks we are stabilizing, but for instance, in Georgia, there was no scaffolding. So the first project for a very huge block to stabilize, we had to use scaffolding in wood, like in this case. But also we had to transfer to them all the basic knowledge. For instance, if you have a pipe with a mortar, you don't have the pipe located like this, but you have to fix the pipe in the lowest part because otherwise the pipe is closed. And for all this kind of job, we were very lucky to have one colleague of us that was working with Rodio for many years, and Trevi, that are the two main companies in Italy. And now he was supporting our approach. But also we found solutions in order, and we explained to them that any anchors, passive anchors like this, passive bar, must be covered in order not to impact on the archaeological site. And finally, the result was that in this big block, which was containing a huge tunnel that was the main entrance to the town in the past, probably Professor Pedro Scavia remember this place when we visited together the site, now is fully stabilized without the risk of collapsing of the block. For the others, we use the scaffoldings, like in this case, or climbers, like in this case, all the times with the local companies. So we trained the local company also to install the metallic net that was placed in some areas where there were many unconsolidated blocks possibly falling down. And this project, we are very happy to say that this year, just a few weeks ago, was awarded by the European Commission and Europa Nostra as best consolidation. What's happening here? As best consolidation project for the years 2021. And here you can see some of the work that has been done in this movie that was displayed in the European Commission just on 25th of May, just 3 weeks ago. with the local people working. Some of the slides you already remember, the monitoring systems that we mentioned partially, and the restoration of the many collapses we did. So this was a really very, very important, interesting project. But similar in Georgia, we have been working transferring this approach, and this company that's now working there, it has been involved in other sites like up in Sike. And but in this case, they're even using the hanging scaffolding. So they are also making quite good. But consolidation is not all the time easy. So this is the case of Afghanistan, in which after the explosion, the entire niche were ready to collapse. And we had to start investigating how to solve the problems. And we together with the people from Trevi in Cesena, we defined a project in which we made the idea of a consolidation of the site with passive anchors. But this site, as you remember, was affected by slaking in the strata with siltstone. And also it was very fragile because of the explosion. So we had to balance vibration and slaking in our consolidation. So it means a heavy equipment where we are with a rotopercussion hammer, where we are very far from the niche, but medium heavy equipment with rotary when we are close to the niche, and also light equipment or even very light equipment where we are inside the niche for very small blocks. But when we have the rotary, we need the water for cooling, but water can produce the slaking. So we had to manage all the times, all these elements. And finally, the results was also in this case satisfactory. And also to be sure that the result was good, we made some pullout tests and anchor suitability tests just to verify that everything was done in the proper way. Inside the niche was slightly different. We had to use a scaffolding with small anchors, carbon fiber anchors or stainless steel anchors. And also in this case, making recourse to the local people. We trained the local people to do this job. And this was quite good because this was a kind of restoration and they can also do in the past. And finally, we used it also to fill some of the cracks, making injection from outside. In order to avoid the water infiltration into the niches and also to stabilize better the niche. And this was also a good achievement. In a similar place, this is a nice story. We have 6 minutes more. And in Shahrizak, also in Afghanistan, there is a problem of a fortress that is affected by soil erosion. And we found that one of the possibilities, together with other measurements, we have a publication on this, was also to use the local bushes like this one. But this kind of local bushes is also used by the local population for fires because it's cold in this area. So we made an agreement with the local people to have an arsenal for these bushes. And then we negotiated to have 50% of the bushes to be used for the soil erosion and 50% of the bushes to be used for them. But because of this, they will not touch the bushes that has been placed and located in the upper part of the cliff. And this is one of the projects of UNESCO still pending, and we will see how it will be managed. We mentioned that this is a project that was not, unfortunately, going very well. You remember the problem of the weathering in Lalibela. Lalibela is a beautiful place in Ethiopia. It was the problem was the Mount Morillonite and the water infiltration. It was protected by the past. But when we were studying how together with UNESCO how to manage, there was a big funding from the European Union in this case to protect the site. And unfortunately, what they decided to do was to have big shelters like this, as you can see. I am personally against this kind of shelter because it's terrible if you consider the environmental impact of this. This is exactly the opposite of what we are doing in our sites. So to maintain the authenticity and the integrity. But in this case, they constructed like a pump station. So unfortunately, they said that this is a temporary. Okay, if it is temporary, I agree. Finally, a different approach we used in Petra. I will go very fast. In Petra, we provide the guideline for the local people and then they implemented by themselves. the consolidation of the unstable areas. In fact, you can see here we started with scaling unstable loose block in the SIC in the canyon using local people in this case. Fixing a stable block in the SIC, in this case, they use the Italian company, as far as we know, and also anchoring stable blocks. So little by little, they are implementing the guideline with the support of donors and funders for these projects. Finally, just a few words about discussion. Protection and conservation of cultural heritage from landslides is a science at the border between geotechnical engineering and rock mechanics. Archaeology and history of art, and finally social sciences, especially when operating in low-income countries. So it's a complex, and the harmonization of advanced solutions with historical heritage further requires mitigation projects, sometimes pioneering with a design that is minimizing the impact of new intervention, possibly recovering traditional materials and or solutions, and or the reuse of the original construction techniques. But as was mentioned by Vigiani also in the past, the conservation of monuments and historical sites is one of the most challenging problems, and it involves a number of factors belonging to different fields, cultural, humanistic, social, technical, economic, and administrative sometimes, intertwining in inextricable patterns. So this complexity, it was the background for our investigation and approach, and also as we mentioned by Calabresi, sometimes in the past there was an approach to simplify the project and to have just an engineering approach or a restoration approach that was not taking consideration all the different aspects. But also you saw some interesting models. I used to very often to the words of Hunger, which made a list of some common misconceptions that must be with us when we are working in these sites. That means that the results baked by analysis is always superior to that based on subjective judgment. So this is a misconception, as was mentioned by Hunger. And I used to say all the times, so to remember to myself, or to remember to the people that are listening to this lecture, how a theory is reliable if all the mathematics is correct. And this is also not correct. A theory that is more complicated is always superior to that which is simple. And this is not true as well. So Hunger was very good in understanding this principle. A theoretical statistical hypothesis can replace missing data. Complex field or remote sensing measurement are always more reliable than simple observation. Also not true, you have to put your hand, your foot on the side. A good theory needs no calibration against field observation. This is also another misconception. A good theory needs field calibrations. And unreliability is caused only by the variation of the ground, but we are reliable. The ground is not reliable. This is the idea. So I really like this list. And this is just to remember that when we're dealing with heritage sites, we have to have this concept in our mind. And also when we are trying to understand how to manage, we also used to make reference to what it was proposed by Barland in 1987, that is the famous Barland triangle, in which this mainly related to the soil mechanics, but useful also for our approach, in which understanding the ground profile is essential, and we saw different cases about this. We have to develop an appropriate model. We saw some cases. We need the monitoring of observed behavior. But finally, we need the human experience. That means a precedent empiricism and well winnowed experience. There is no technology alone, no approach alone that can solve a problem without the human being involved in this approach. So finally, this is the last slide. The most important concept to be used in the conservation is that from a complex situation I described before, there is certainly the need to improve the information on geological and geotechnical data, but this has to be combined with empiricism and experience. This is to say that emerging technologies can provide a very useful support to the increase of knowledge, as reported in the previous slides, but in the final decision, they have to be mediated by the professional judgment of involved experts. And in cultural heritage conservation, at least other two additional sectors have to be considered, such as archaeology and history of art and social sciences. respectively to guarantee the proper conservation and integrity and authenticity, as well as in low-income countries, to guarantee the use of traditional and local knowledge and involvement in local manpower. That's all. I really thank you very much with an auspicious, with I hope that really this approach to the sciences of the cultural heritage will be probably possibly a new discipline, a new approach, a new way of working for the future. Thank you very, very much for your staying here. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot, Professor Margottini. Now we have to move to the next section, and all the questions to Professor Margottini can be made during the discussion at 3:50.